which is the fuel on how we're moving forward, we use the 8 5s and 2s. What do we want to create? An ideation? What are the ideas? What are we going to brainstorm for how we're going to take LR Future to a new level or learning center? Who do we need to connect in with? What are we going to use for a presentation? And then it takes you into the blue, which is the resource sharing, logistical, what's it going to cost us to do what we're doing. Sylvie, I'm talking about the 8 5 2 that we use.
Okay.
So can you hold up, like, did everyone, I sent, I think, everyone a copy of the Synergy conversations through some PDFs?
Like these ones, right?
Yeah.
That's the 6.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you get that, Emmanuel?
I'm just trying to pull it up right now. I believe so.
Michelle, you cut yours out, Michelle.
Well, let's see. Let's see. Look here. Oh, awesome.
But are they black and white, Michelle, or they're...
Let's see if they come... Unicorn.
Okay, so how about, Lori, why don't you give a download a bit about what you think conversation types are, just to...
Okay, so what I can say about them is, and I'm going to use a true example of what we've used in our office at my company here, LR Future. So we're having a marketing meeting. There's Sylvia and I and a guy that does our graphic design, Andy. So we sit down and we pull out the 8 5 2. So we talk about, we brainstorm ideas. What's going to work with us for marketing? This is all the ideas. What's the design look like? What do we need to upgrade to? All that kind of stuff. So those are the conversations. It keeps us on task. And we go, okay, what marketing tools are we going to use? Who are we going to connect in with? Who do we need to enroll in this? So golden opportunities, let's just use them for example. We want to enroll that company because they co-op with us. And how's that going to look? And how do we do all this stuff? And then what's it going to cost us? So when you look at a marketing meeting and you go, okay, what's the ideas? Because how can we take the product we want to get out there in marketing? How do we create it to be different? Because there's so many things that are the same in the financial world. How do we create it and make it different to fit the people? And then what's the cost going to be for these ideas? We're going to use the chamber newsletter. What's that going to cost? How's it going to impact us? And is it value for its money?
Okay,
and how do we maintain? Because if we don't have the money, how do we do it, right?
Okay, thank you. Okay. Does everyone understand the concept that conversations change, and these cards are giving you conversational types that are telling you when the conversation changes? Does everyone kind of get that?
So when we're having our marketing meeting, we're not pulling the conversation cards. We're just pulling the different, say, marketing cards or whatever. But within those cards, those conversation changes, right?
Well,
is that what you're saying?
Just saying, like, in general, let's say Lori was coming up and says, okay, we got to do some marketing. We got to come up with some ideas of what we're going to do. And in general, when you don't have something like this, you go through a bit of an agenda of, hey, we need to identify our target markets and we need to figure out maybe one new product and we need to understand what social media to use. And the conversation can kind of go all over the place, but it's usually based upon an agenda, right? But there isn't a specific, like, conversational type where you go, we have to brainstorm now these ideas. And then we have to do a needs analysis of what our target market needs. And then we have to come up with a designing idea, a conversation about the flyers we're going to design. So what this does is it information flows between people, right? And I'm just going into an instruction now. And I had sort of delegated to Lori to give her impression that he was using the cards for. So each time there's a shift in these kind of types of conversations, it happens unconsciously. Conversations just move around. And some people that are very good at it know how to move it around. But a lot of times, conversations don't quite go where we want them to go because humans haven't learned yet this kind of unique skill of identifying specific conversations that you're in. And then as a facilitator or as a group, being able to move from one to the other. Usually you have an agenda item that you go, okay, we're going to talk about this. And then the facility, and then you kind of stick to that thing. And then once you've done that, you go to the next one, right? So it's usually based upon the content. It's based upon the specific content that you want to talk about. But so what I noticed was that a lot of people would get trapped in stories. This person was always telling stories all the time. And that person's always explaining things. And that person always trying to make themselves look good. Credibility conversation. And so I started to track and write down all these patterns that I was seeing. And it started with 15, 20, and then it kept going up and up and up. And then I realized within a business situation, which is your synergy wheel, you have research conversations. You have infrastructure conversations. You have learning conversations. You have operations conversations. You have creativity conversations. You have synergy conversations. You have services conversations, marketing conversations. You have stewardship conversations. And they're different. Like if we're doing research, we need to test things. We need to share knowledge. We need to investigate. And it's very different from marketers who are going like, we need a needs analysis. We got to do a presentation. We need to enroll the people. So the person that's a marketer is very different from the person who's a researcher. And the conversations that they have are very different. And so what these cards do, and I think it could be like breakthrough within the new paradigm tool. And what I'm working on a software program now to actually have chat rooms that are programmed to be a conversational type. So if we took you as a group and said, okay, we need to brainstorm all the ideas for revenue streams for the learning center, that would be one conversation. And then we need a critical analysis conversation to go through those ideas. Let's say you come up with 20 of them and come up with the top five that are going to work. And then once you've done that, you take those five and you go, now we need a design specs conversation to really look at each one of these revenue streams and specifically flesh out what they need. And then we need to look at our target markets and do a needs analysis and figure out what they need. And then we need a bit of an exploration conversation to figure out how are these needs going to meet our products and connect them together, right? And so this to me is very, you know, bing, 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 because I have all this in my mind. But for some people who are professional marketers, they have a process to do so. But for some people, let's say that you're teaching to learn about business, they have no idea about this. They have no idea that you do a needs analysis first and then a presentation. You don't give a presentation before you find out what they need. And that's like in Michael Gerber's E-Myth. You know, he says, you have to do the needs analysis and don't do the presentation while you're doing the needs analysis. They have to be two separate conversations. So there's a lot of business gurus who have developed formulas that use these conversation types. But I've never seen anywhere anyone who's identified them in this manner. So when we're looking at the synergy wheel and we're looking at these positions, each person, like a researcher, again, has a different mind than a marketer. And if you're dealing with, like on your board, and you have someone who's a brilliant researcher and they go into the marketing position, it's not going to work. And so the idea is that you're finding what are the gifts of each person. Like Emmanuel may be perfect at the infrastructure because he's an accountant, he's looking at resources, and it makes sense that he's going to be doing the accounting of what is going on. But maybe deep in his heart, he goes, you know, I want to be a teacher. You know, I do accounting over here, but I want to teach kids because I never taught kids before, and that's actually what I want to do. So there's a big distinction between what people are doing right now and kind of good at versus what they really want to do. And I think that in the learning center, that if you can help people, right, to bring their gifts into the world within this new paradigm business structure, that you guys are like light years ahead of anyone else around there. Now that's a big download. Any questions? So what I sent you was the beginning. Like Lori already has like all the cards, and at some point, I would like to hope that you would like to each have your own card sets. And I sent you these synergy conversations. And the synergy conversations deal with relationships. And if you look at them, there's some very important conversations. And one of them is the healing and the clearing. And I think that in any type of organization, people do things that annoy other people. And the thing that kills organizations are conflict. And the clearing conversation type is the conversation that I think is one of the hardest of the 72. And that's when someone's bugging you and someone has annoyed you, that you can have a conversation with them and say, look, I would like to clear with you. And they know, okay, something's coming. And then Laurie may talk to Sylvia and go, you know, Sylvia, you put your coffee cup on my favorite coaster. And I never told anyone, but I don't like anyone putting their coffee cup on my coaster. You may go, I didn't know that. You know, I didn't know that. and you know, all humans, we have these little irritations, right? We don't like people doing certain things, and we don't know what it is, and we piss each other off. And these things build up, we never talk about it. And then at some point, then there's a real conflict, and then all that pent-up energy kills the relationship, and you have this parting of ways, and because they did not know how to clear. And so in some families, they never clear anything, right? They just get into fights, and then they go back, and they get into fights, and they go back. But to actually understand that if I'm bringing something up that annoys me, it doesn't mean that I'm criticizing you. It doesn't mean that you're bad. It just means that I'm holding something inside that as soon as I express it, usually it's gone. But if I don't express it, and if I feel I can express it, I'm never going to feel close to you because I don't feel that I can kind of open up and tell you these things. So this is just one of the conversation types. You could have courses at the Learning Center on each of the conversational types. You can do courses on negotiation. You can do courses on needs analysis. You could go into the community and find out who are the best people at these conversation types and bring them in, and you take a percentage, you set the courses up, and you could have a curriculum for the whole year on just conversation types. Think about how that would affect the community if you're giving, you know, courses on healing conversations, you know, giving couple.
I love that.
Me too.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
So then the conversation has two things that it can be programmed with. It's like, let's say you have a healing conversation, and in nonviolent communication, they talk about compassion and they talk about needs. So you have a healing conversation and you program the healing conversation with the intention of compassion. You're bringing your full compassion. Someone is telling you their pain. You know it's a healing conversation. And then what do you focus on with your mind? You focus on need. You wrote a whole book about it. Like, this nonviolent communication went across the whole planet based upon one spell. And the spell was a healing conversation with the intention of compassion, where you focus on need. And then you ask, like, you're in pain, I'm mad, I'm angry, whatever I'm doing. And what do? What do you need right now? From your heart, you're speaking from compassion. And the person, I need you to shut up. Okay, and they tell you. And as soon as they tell you their need, it changes. Because if you hear their need, that's what they're mad about. They're not getting what they need. So they're angry. And so he built a whole communication platform on that one thing. And that's just one spell. There are literally billions of spells. Like, you can take 100 values cards, 72 conversation cards, over 200 conceptual cards, and each one of them is a spell. You can do, like, let's say, accuracy is the value, needs analysis is the conversational type, and want. You know, how much can you identify what they want and how accurate are you? So as a business person, if you can do that, again, you're heads and tails above other people who just have a product and are constantly trying to sell it, but they actually don't understand what the customer wants. They've never done a needs analysis to kind of figure out what that is. So not only can you create courses just on the conversational types, you can then create courses specifically on patterns called spells that you can just generate. Like Lori right now could generate 100 spells. Here's a value, here's a combo type, here's a concept. And all of the concepts, if you see, the concepts on the cards are like concepts on the synergy wheel. So if you're looking at research, if you're looking at infrastructure, if you're looking at synergy, it's how you look at the business. So if Emmanuel is talking to a client and the client's talking about some of the services of the business that they're doing, the services are very different from the operations. The operations are the inside that you have to do, that you don't get paid for. The services are all the services that you're getting paid for. So what the Inflow Matrix is doing is giving you all the different parts of the business on cards, so that then when they flip up, you're seeing through a lens that particular part of the business. And that's very different from seeing, you know, business plans on white paper with a whole paragraph. When you take the cards and you use them as lenses, you're using them to see all the different things you would never see. And when you use divination, it brings the cards up in a way that you would never think to look at it. But as soon as the divination brings it up, you go, oh, I see. And when you're using it with other people, you see it together. Mm-hmm. So that's another kind of long download, but I don't usually get to let her loose like this. But so does that make sense? Like, is that like whenever I talk too much, I'm used to the eyes of the people kind of going, yeah.
I get it conceptually. What I need to get is implementation. So if we have if we decide we have 8 board members and we go through the mapping process and everything like that, we don't have the software now to point click the edges of the paper or anything, but say we have, okay, so it's the second Wednesday, whenever it is, I've lost track of the month, it is our board meeting. We have this, we have 8 people, we have Inflow Matrix map, and we have a board meeting happening in an hour. What happens?
Okay. Well, then let's say Lori's the facilitator. Okay. And you may, the first 5 minutes, you may go, okay, welcoming, you have a bit of a check-in, find out where everyone's at. And then let's say you've decided that you're going to bring in the information about what you've learned to present to the board to get their buy-in to use the Inflow Matrix as an operating system, right? That to me would probably be your next step. Mm-hmm. And then I would suggest that Lori might start out and show her map from her business and give a bit of a 10-minute download. And that might be a presentation, a conversation of, here's the map that you did. And then Lori to say why it worked for her to run her business. And then it might go that the next step after saying that, you might want to give a bit of a storytelling, and maybe Emmanuel's there and he gives a bit of a storytelling about the course that you're taking right now. And you give the story about these 5 sessions, about what he's been learning or what you've been learning, and why, after what Lori said, he might say why he thinks that the technology that you're learning is going to give the learning center an edge. not just give it an edge, it gives an operating system, it gives products to sell, but then can integrate any other products that people want to do, any other courses. And then you might have an investigation conversation, which may be facilitated by Sylvia, where you ask the board members, get their input, and find out what they had thought they were going to do before getting this. If you didn't do anything, what would you have done? How would you have run the learning center? What were you thinking? What were their ideas? And you get their input.
So just to which step, like which one was the setup? Was a presentation setup part one? Are we using this?
Yeah. Okay. Like the start would be the welcoming. The setup would be Lori giving her input about the presentation. And then the build-up would be Emmanuel giving his input about what he learned here. And then the crescendo would be actually to get them to give their input about maybe not just what they were thinking, but what is their ideal? What do they want in terms of the outputs for the learning center? And then maybe the ease out, maybe Michelle, you could facilitate that. And you might be able to do a brainstorm on the possibilities that could be created by what they just learned. And then connect and unify, you might do a meditation. And maybe Lori leads a meditation. And you know, I don't know how you are, guys, with guided meditations, but to do guided meditation just to bring everyone together. I mean, maybe you want to maybe do that at the welcoming, maybe do that at the beginning and do guided meditation at the beginning. That's a bit different. And then maybe at the finish, you set up a Zoom call with me to then take that group, everybody, through a process online and to get their buy-in to do that. And that would be an enrollment conversation. How does that sound?
So the finish is like the next step? Like you're not having that conversation in that last 5 minutes. That's...
Well, yeah, I mean, the timing is kind of like, here's the ideal. And then you kind of, depending upon how things are work, like the meditation might take 7 minutes and not 10 minutes. So you got a bit more time. So I find.
So you're including this conversation with you in this meeting?
No. That's just the next step.
Okay.
I'm saying like.
I'm very. What's next? What's next? What's next? And when you describe this, I think that Lori and Sylvia have consciously been bringing a lot of these elements in already with, you know, the grounding and the centering and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But what my experience is, what is missing is what's next and who's doing it. Mm-hmm. And what's the deadline? And right now we're swirling in financial uncertainty. We don't have a human being dedicated and receiving money for their time to nudge things forward. So what I feel like we've been missing, we had it for a while with when we had the context and a looming deadline of the conference and all that kind of stuff, which was excellent because it brought into sharp focus a lot of things. And, you know, here, but landing here, and then of course COVID and blah, 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 blah. But that's what I was looking for, was the connect and unify, and the finish is next. And who and what? And I just flip back to my normal traditional.
Well, I told you, right? The next step would be getting online with me in a Zoom. Mm-hmm. And something me and Lori talked about last night was, I don't know if I'm going to go on a tour and start to teach in different cities. Mm-hmm. I've got networks in about 5 or 6 different cities. And I was thinking at some point of coming out to you guys for about a month and helping train, helping getting the learning center going, and bring my tools, because I've got a lot of tools that are very
that would be great.
Exceptional.
And I think we were approaching there of exactly like we had next steps and we got Rhonda lined up for her coffee thing and this, that, and the other thing, and then the door slammed shut again. So it added another layer of.
If I can finish.
I'm sorry, I apologize.
That you need a sort of like event in the future to kind of galvanize people, get them excited. And the whole idea of creating a shared knowledge community would be like a weekend long or maybe a week long thing where I come like 2 or 3 weeks ahead of time to help prepare and get things ready. And then we have a weekend where we take like 144 people through a major process where we charge the money and money go, you know, the money split up in percentages depending upon, you know, what it needs to go. And I was thinking like $500 per person, and that could be like $72,000 that gets divided between, you know, different parts that need it. And that could be the sort of launch for the learning center into being the hub for a shared knowledge community, which would be the first one perhaps on the planet to create this new paradigm business structure.
Yay.
So if you present also that to the board and have my buy-in like to do that, then we start to arrange the steps along the way to make sure that that's a success and do all the marketing necessary to get the people there and for me to get all the tools and things ready. And then again, have enough time in Yorkton, because I've been there before and I've stayed with Lori, to, you know, set your learning center up into a space age learning center that will blow everyone out of the water.
I've always thought of Yorkton itself as a hub, because we're often known as a hub here. So when you say that, Elijah, like, I don't even know how. Like, you're saying things that I'm feeling and I felt for a long time, but I like that idea of the event in the future. We get the learning center set up and we are like there in Saskatchewan, in this area, this hub of Yorkton. And it's not your same old conference. You know, every time you think of a conference, it's a same old, just different speakers, same old. This is something that would blow people out of off this planet, like literally.
Yeah.
I mean, 144. What's 144 people?
It's nothing.
Nothing.
No. On Saturday, I've been asked to present on this Unify. There's like a massive thing happening on the planet, 12 different stages, and a student of mine has asked me to present with him. And it could be the first time for people seeing my work, like in numbers.
Oh, wow.
And we're using the thing I just sent you. We're using that. We're bringing like 6 other top thinkers together that are going to present for 2 hours and go through not quite what you've been going through, but start to present it to like the Buckminster Fuller Institute. I don't know all the organizations, but top level organizations. So as it approaches, my own work is getting forward in other areas because I'm not just working with you guys, and this is the year to bring the work into the world. So, you know, there will be a momentum that will begin to focus, and it won't just be offline. Online, it'll be offline, and we might be able to bring a lot of people to watch what we're doing there. So it's kind of like looking at the learning center, you know, it's not just offline. There's tons you can do online. And again, since you guys are the first guys, you guys get all the attention.
Mm-hmm. Very cool.
So I think we're over time. I mean, we started out by having a bit of a chat, but we're coming, I think, to the end. I want to kind of keep to the time. Any questions? Or Manuel, haven't heard from you. Are you, how's it landing?
Processing. I'm digesting right now. I will have feedback and commentary. I just like to digest first.
Okay. And I with the third group, I spent the time to make some nice maps, because I know you've done the 5 communication spaces and you might have penciled it out or something, but I sent to Lori, I think Manuel, or you've already started. I need 6 photo. If you want to do it, it's like $100, which I think is fairly reasonable. And then you can use the maps with your own clients to show this is what I did and would you like one, and then it's a good marketing material for you, but I need like a personal space photo, just you, a one-on-one space photo. I went through their Facebook and just did it. If you don't want to choose and you want me to choose, I can just look on your Facebook and I'll choose.
So you need
a personal space photo, one-on-one space, like one, just you and somebody else. The group one, just you in a group, and then community one, you in a larger community space, and the sacred space is kind of like whatever you want. Yeah.
Sent that to you guys by email. That's one that Elijah created. And like he said, he just went on to Facebook. And you know, Elijah, it's funny how you say that. If you guys don't want to choose your photos, he'll just go on your Facebook and find them. But I'm going like, that's a lot of time for you. But then maybe there's something you see in those photos. Like if we can't take responsibility and get six photos to you, how the hell are we going to run a learning center? Because this man is very valuable and his time is so much bigger than searching someone's Facebook to get photos. So I'm going to say if we wanted to commit to a map, each individual person, we get him those photos. For the map that's got the group and the, you know, the very first map we did? But I sent the picture to you so you guys will see some ideas on it because I sent it as an email yesterday to everybody.
And Matthew Learning, he the guy, the picture I sent it to, he's already got a group of four people that he's going to start teaching. One of his lifetime goals was to become the world's richest man. So I said, somebody's got to take what I got and do something with it. I mean, there's a big difference between making the tools and then using the tools to go do what you're going to do. And most of my time is put on actually making the tools. So I've got a lot to catch up with. But, I mean, the world's your oyster. Everyone out there needs a values map. You know, everyone. And once you start to do it with people, everyone's going to want to do it. So I just suggest to you, like, one of the ideas is really to teach, you know, you or anyone else within your group to make $100 an hour online. You know, for most people, they go to university, spend $30,000 4 years, and they come out, they make $20 an hour. So, you know, I think that's a pretty good business proposition.
No doubt.
And so, like, part of what I'm doing here is that I wanted to make it reasonable, very reasonable, and to give very high value. And just to show you, you know, this is 25 years of work distilled down into one map, which I think is extremely valuable. So I don't think the $100 or the $25 is an equation of the value. But I just want to do it in such a way that everyone can get access to it and they can use it towards creating whatever they want in their own financial world.
Thank you.
I think the more as a learning center we can teach that, the better it is for all the people. And Emmanuel and I spoke of that today. You look at Maslow's hierarchy, how many people are at that level where all they're worried about right now, and especially during COVID, is food, shelter, this kind of stuff. We're all sitting a little higher on that thing. And if we're all going there, we just want to be up here. We don't care about those people. Then are we really developing and inspiring and growing humanity? So we had that perfect conversation this morning. So if we're there as a learning center, allowing people to step into their power through values mapping and different things like that and doing this, and they're making $100 an hour, what are they doing for themselves and their families and the people around them? And our systems.
I mean, imagine if in Saskatchewan you guys had the reputation that the minimum wage that you were teaching was 100 an hour. How much attention you think you'd get? You know, you'd have lineups around the block, right? People from all Saskatchewan coming to see you or going online because people are again, if you're at the bottom, you're getting minimum wage, $15 an hour. You know. And this is easy. All you got to do is follow what we've been doing. And how simple is that? You don't need accreditation, credibility, nothing. Just take people through a process.
Very cool.
Okay, so I'm going to go. Thank you for listening to me. I was a little bit more of a talking head today. I hope that wasn't too much. I don't usually get the chance to sort of... I learned not to because it's a little much. rather give people the experience of learning it on their own.
Can you send us some information about this event you're taking part in?
Yeah, I'll send that to you. Yeah. Okay, that's 11 till 1 on Saturday. It's called the Synergy Stage, which is funny enough. I'll tell you that word synergy is coming up, and so I'm going to synergize them in the synergy wheel. And that's the first time I'm taking like 9 sort of thinking leaders kind of together into one system to kind of inflow matrix them. So it's a bit exciting.
Awesome. The recordings, are you posting them on YouTube?
Yeah, they're being posted to Planetary Guardians. If you look up Planetary Guardians on YouTube, you're up there. And I'm kind of like I'm barely keeping up to my workload. I wish I was better with sort of putting them up and sending them out, but I just kind of put them up and on to the next thing. So.
I'll find them and post them on Life Matters.
Okay. And at some point I am making a website where all the stuff will be up and then you can use this for your own marketing purposes. But
I'm not honestly that sure how excited I am about having these highly publicized.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, right now they're not at all. So. I mean, the thing is, to me, this is history being made.
Yeah, I wouldn't put it on Learning Center Facebook, Sylvia.
No. Okay.
No, not yet, because we're just developing this and we want to take this out there as the hub of the Learning Center. So yeah, I wouldn't.
Okay.
I wouldn't take it out there.
My request at this point, I mean, it's for a resource, a learning resource on Elijah's channel is one thing, but.
No. Thank you, Michelle. That was really good.
Thank you.
Okay. So see you guys.
Thank you, Elijah.
And, bye. I'll see you soon.
Okay. See you next week.